Since 1946, the U.S. Pentagon has operated a military training center for Latin American soldiers, known as the School of the Americas. In all, it has trained roughly 70,000 Latin American soldiers in what it refers to as counterinsurgency operations. The school has become a focus of attention as many of its graduates have been found to have committed a range of crimes in their home countries, ranging from torture to mass killing. Panama's Manuel Noriega, Argentina's Leopoldo Galtieri, and Guatemala's Rios Montt are just three of the 10 Latin American dictators who attended the School of the Americas before seizing power by military coup. In some cases, entire elite units have been trained at the school, such as El Salvador's Atlacat Battalion, responsible for various war crimes including the killing of at least 1,000 civilians over a three-day massacre in the town of El Masote, and the 1989 assassination of six Jesuit priests, their co-worker, and her daughter. The Real News spoke to Pablo Ruiz, a member of the Chilean chapter of the organization School of the Americas Watch. Pablo is visiting the United States for the first time to demand that President Obama close the school so that no more Latin Americans endure what he experienced when he was just 20 years old, when agents of Augusto Pinochet's military regime detained him for spray painting anti-government graffiti.
Yo estuve prisionero en el año 89 y en el año 90 en pleno gobierno del general Pinochet. Fui torturado por la policía, se me aplicó corriente, fui brutalmente golpeado. Cuando llegó la democracia, recuperé mi libertad y un tribunal civil me declaró inocente de todos los cargos que me había hecho la policía. Producto de eso, de mi experiencia, cuando supe en el año 2000 que Chile seguía enviando militares a este instituto en Estados Unidos, la Escuela de la América. Como víctima de la tortura, dije que esto era un escándalo. Es un escándalo que Chile siga mandando soldados a una institución que ha enseñado tortura.
The same torture tactics that Pablo was exposed to can be found within the school's training manuals that were declassified by the Pentagon in 1996. Pablo spoke to us just hours after reading the manuals in person for the first time during a visit to the National Archives.
He leído esos manuales, me da mucha tristeza comprobar con mis propios ojos. Se les dice a los militares que asesinen, que torturen, que hagan desaparecer. Cuando uno lo lee, se da cuenta y entiende por qué los militares de América Latina hicieron lo que hicieron. No fue algo que se les ocurrió de la noche a la mañana. Ellos fueron preparados para hacer desaparecer, para torturar y todo eso.
But according to Pablo, the school teaches more than just tactics. It promotes a specific philosophy.
Bueno, la Escuela de la América, a mi juicio, sigue promoviendo el concepto antiguo de la doctrina de seguridad nacional. Enseña directa o indirectamente a los militares a mirar a los estudiantes, a los trabajadores, a los campesinos, como posibles enemigos. Ya la lucha no es hacia afuera, sino es una lucha hacia adentro. Por eso es común en América Latina, en México, en Chile, en distintos países, ver a los militares que reprimen manifestaciones o a la policía. Eso es parte de la enseñanza de la doctrina de seguridad nacional.
In reviewing the declassified manuals, the definition of potential targets includes local or national political party teams or parties that have goals, beliefs, or ideologies contrary or in opposition to the national government. According to the manuals, even electoral politics are considered insurgent activity. The manual states that insurgents can resort to subverting the government by means of elections, in which the insurgents cause the replacement of an unfriendly government official to one favorable to their cause. According to Pablo, getting information on the school's activities is getting increasingly difficult.
Antiguamente, el gobierno de Estados Unidos publicaba la lista de los militares latinoamericanos que venían a la escuela. Y nosotros, cuando había una violación de los derechos humanos, chequeábamos si algún militar o policía estaba involucrado en la Escuela de la América y en violación a los derechos humanos. Y así nos dimos cuenta que uno de cada cuatro miembros de la policía secreta de Pinochet estuvo en la Escuela de las Américas. Actualmente el Pentágono entrega los listados, pero tachados. Uno no puede saber quién está viniendo a la Escuela de las Américas. Por lo tanto, uno no puede fiscalizar si esos militares que vienen a la Escuela de las Américas están actualmente cometiendo violaciones a los derechos humanos. En Colombia, que es el principal país que envía soldados, hay una gran cantidad de violación a los derechos humanos. Pero para nosotros es necesario que se publiquen los nombres. Por lo tanto, yo creo que no hay transparencia y ese Estados Unidos tiene que desclasificar los nombres de los soldados latinoamericanos que vienen acá.
The worst allegations of what is taught at the school have been confirmed in testimony by former instructors, like Major Joseph Blair.
I served in the United States Army from 1968 to 1989. My very last assignment was as a political military officer and instructor at the School of the Americas from 1986 to 1989. I served with the U.S. Army officer who both developed the curriculum to teach torture techniques, physical abuse, false imprisonment, infiltration of unions.
El objetivo es que los países respondan a los intereses de Estados Unidos y si se alejan, golpes de Estado, como en el caso de Venezuela, que todos sabemos que los militares que participan en el intento de golpe fueron graduados de la Escuela de la América. En Chile, ¿por qué siguen tantos militares viniendo? O sea, Estados Unidos quiere tener la seguridad que los militares, en el caso de que Michelle Bachelet haga reformas y ataque el sistema neoliberal, obviamente va a utilizar a esos militares para hacer un golpe. Hoy día, afortunadamente, los militares se mantienen dentro de la legalidad, pero te aseguro que si Michelle Bachelet hiciera las reformas que está haciendo Hugo Chávez, obviamente van a propiciar un golpe de Estado. La historia de América Latina sí lo demuestra. Golpes de Estado, invasiones, son decenas, decenas y decenas. Es el interés de quizás del Ministerio de Defensa, del Pentágono, el interés de tener esta escuela para tener los contactos con los militares. Y fundamentalmente, ¿para qué? Para proteger los intereses de las grandes corporaciones, de los grandes intereses económicos, no para proteger al pueblo común y corriente de Estados Unidos. Estados Unidos, que ahora estamos viviendo en una crisis, gasta mucha, mucha plata en esta institución militar. Esa plata debería ir a los jóvenes drogadictos que están en las calles, a atacar la pobreza, a destinar esos recursos al empleo. ¿Cómo Estados Unidos se puede dar el lujo de gastar sus recursos, gastar los impuestos en una academia militar que solamente le ha traído desprestigio a Estados Unidos?
Donate today and receive a new documentary film available to members of the Real News Network. The History of the National Security State with legendary author Gore Vidal. Bonus features of the DVD include an in-depth response to Vidal from ex-CIA analyst Ray McGovern, who served under 7 U.S. presidents, an exclusive interview with Colin Powell's former chief of staff Larry Wilkerson, and an insightful interview with oil policy analyst Antonia Yuhas.
The news magazine of the screen. Living glimpses of history in the making.
Hollywood and Washington has a symbiotic relationship. They both deal with illusions. Reality doesn't often play much of a part. I think I saw through the myth of the Cold War almost from the beginning. I was a Washington political kid from a political family. Roosevelt first had radio because he had this great speaking voice and everyone liked to hear. Truman proceeded to break every arrangement that Roosevelt had set up for a peaceful coexistence. And Truman thought that it would be a good idea. Why not just stay armed all the time? And then he devised the national security state. You've got to go up and swear allegiance to the United States or else you're a commie. I mean, we had imported fascism. We get Dwight Eisenhower, who said that we have this great military industrial complex. It is a dangerous thing. And he said, this is going to change everything. And the way our country's governed is going to change us politically. Along comes Jack Kennedy, who wanted to make his mark, believed in the Cold War. But he said, in this kind of politics, it is the appearance of things that matters. I think everybody should take a sober look at the world about us. The national security state still exists, only it isn't communism anymore, it's terrorism. This is the most serious thing that has happened in the history of the United States. Knowledge is power. We need an honest news system.
We need the real news.
This is the sort of thing we can build right now without anyone else's permission from the government or from the business community. It's the powers in our hands.
If we're not going to sleepwalk into more wars, we think we need to start with a television news network that won't bow to pressure and has the courage to seek facts. And that means independent economics. And that's why we need you.
Make a tax-deductible donation now of at least $10 a month or a one-time give of at least $75. As a thank you for your support, we will send you the new documentary film, The History of the National Security State.